So Jason is, Jason's been a long time friend of mine. I mean, as I said, we met at school, and I've always been amazed by his ability to sort of translate lyrics into, you know, a working song.
Jason is the archetypal rock god frontman.
Really great singer and vocalist, and I mean, a showman in his own right. I mean, he has the ability to turn a bad gig around into a great gig.
The thing with Jason is he's great to be on stage with, because you just don't quite know what's going to happen.
Along the David Coverdale, Danny Bowes from Thunder kind of vibe, that powerful rock voice.
Really great, great, great vocalist, and yeah, one in a million, really.
And a great frontman and a great showman, you know. He could whip up a crowd.
I love Jay. Always have done, actually. He's such a showman. You know, all those years where I just thought, oh, you've got such a big ego. In actual fact, to do what he does, you do need to have a big ego, because the minute he steps on that stage, he just becomes ruthless. He is just absolutely amazing.
If the band's lagging, he has a knack of being able to kind of pick us all up a little bit, and I think that generally involves him getting the crowd on our side. So if we're not kind of feeling it, he gets us there.
And also the other thing with him is he makes me fucking laugh. You know, he will just all of a sudden, out of the blue, change the lyrics to a song.
You go up to a microphone to sing the backing vocal, and half the time he's changed the lyric.
Disgusting, filthy lyrics.
Disgusting or sexually orientated or whatever.
A, to catch the audience out, see if they're paying attention. But B, to crack me up. And sometimes I've been in absolute floods of tears trying to play, because he's just thrown me.
Great to be on stages, because you just don't quite know what's going to happen.
You never know what you're going to get, and that's always good fun to look forward to.
There's been many times when I've walked into a microphone and I've not been able to sing. I've had to come away from the mic because I'm laughing over what I've just heard.
He was doing that back in the Paris days, you know, way before the likes of Steel Panther were doing. They make a living out of it now. We were doing it back then.
But just ultimate showman, and has the complete ability to do it. It amazes me sometimes, you know.
A lot of those sort of rock god frontmen, it's all about, oh, look at me, aren't I wonderful? Jason wasn't like that. Jason was always about fun.
And just a really, really good all-round guy, you know, that knows how to deal with a crowd as well.
Everything you love and everything you hate as well when you play with him, because he really puts you through it before you go on stage.
So you couldn't ask for more in a front man, a man to front a band than Jace. You know, brilliant. So what's through the round window, Jim?
Well, through the round window we have my cabinet of toys.
Oh, look, recognise that one.
Yes, Mr. Gene Simmons.
That's the man who started you all.
He certainly is. That's the man.
On your road of... There he is again, look.
And there he is.
Jim is, I think I'd already mentioned, you know, he's a well-versed musician, lovely guy, very heartfelt and honest about what he wants to do.
There's no bigger compliment I can give Jim, because he is the full package when you come to it. He eats, breathes and sleeps his craft.
Out of all of us, Jim is the real deal, you know. He is a hardened musician throughout.
Brilliant bass player. Always makes me laugh. He's like my little twin when we're up there.
Jim has probably played for more bands than all of us put together. Well, he has. Jim has played for everyone.
He's played for every single band under the sun.
Oh, it's count. It's just absolutely endless.
He's the one guy, I think, out of all of us that has actually experienced music on a kind of day-to-day basis.
I've played with a version of Mott the Hoople with Ariel Bender.
Four different bands playing five different sets, week in, week out, and then still turn up to a Glamsters gig and get it spot on.
I did Dumpy's Rusty Nuts.
I couldn't tell you who he hasn't played with. It's just endless.
We played with Europe, Rod Stewart.
Yeah, out of all of us, I would say he's the most focused.
I've done music workshops and played with Phil Collins, Roachford, Wet Wet Wet.
He's always known what he's wanted.
He knows that instrument inside out and he knows every song.
You want to see some of the guitars,
yeah,
do you?
Yeah. How many guitars have you got?
Well, I did have 88, but I've sold some just recently.
Oh, really?
Chesney Hawkes I've played with. But if you want to see something that's quite nice,
yeah,
this is the Joan Collins.
The Joan Collins?
This is the Joan Collins.
Why do you call it the Joan Collins?
Well, it's covered in Diamante. Wow.
Jim can play any style of music. He can fit into any band.
And so it goes on, really, because I can't remember it all, to be offhand. But it's Jeff King I played with. In fact, I had this made actually to use for the Glamsters.
He brings something else to it. That entertainment, that showmanship, which just oozes out of him when he's on stage.
The Hellraisers, sweet tribute band.
He's just a lovely, talented, amazing guy.
You can look at this, but don't touch it, all right?
Lovely guy. He plays a really mean bass. Got a good voice as well. Sings really good, right? Okay, here we go. So there it is.
So that's the real thing.
That is the real McCoy.
And it's all signed.
And it's all signed. So you got Rick Savage here.
Yeah.
Joe Elliott.
Yeah.
Rick Allen.
Yeah.
Phil Collin. And Vivian Campbell. So that's the present lineup. Yes? Flares, Sweet FA.
I could battle on matching for ages, really.
So do you actually play it?
Yes.
You do?
Yes. Yes, I do, yeah.
Because a lot of, you know, these sort of things, most people who get them, you know, they end up in a museum, in a collection.
Yeah, and yeah.
Don't see the light of day.
The problem is, you see, it at all.
The amount of times he said, that's not how the original goes. You're not playing it like the original goes, because he just knows it. His mind is just full of every single song that has been written in the glam rock era.
Page and Lemon. This is the kitty. No glam rocker is ever without the obligatory, and I'm sorry, but if you're going to play glam rock, right, seriously, there is one bass that you do have to have on your collection, and it happens to be the White Thunderbird. That is, for me, epitomises the 1970s rock thing.
Jim is the real thing, you know, and he's never changed. You know, all of us have changed. You look back at us back in the 80s, we had long hair, you know, and now look at us now. Like me, I just look like a little old lady now.
That's the Union Jack.
But Jim has maintained this look. He's never changed in the 20 years I've known him.
Great sounding instrument, absolutely fantastic bass. Hassan Ramzi, and the beauty about this one, I mean, this has got like a nice sheen to it.
Yeah.
He's lived and breathed music for pretty much all his life.
And yeah, he's the real thing.
Chris Christopherson I played with, but this one lights up. Very metal.
He's unique. He's absolutely unique. And I love him to bits. He's a good guy.
When me and Simon started, our musical journey started together.
Simon is a great rock guitarist. There's nothing a man can't play.
Great guitar player. Absolutely fine player.
He can play anything. Any guitar riff you ask him to play, he will play it.
We have got to a point where you do know what each other are thinking, certainly musically, and you go to do something, he's already on it.
I auditioned for Whitesnake, I auditioned for UFO, I auditioned for The Cult.
He's just brilliant.
Great vocals, some cracking backing vocals from Simon.
He's just a genius with that instrument. He, you know, I am in awe of how he plays that guitar.
If you've got someone there who knows what you're trying to say without saying it, God, it makes it life that much easier.
Twiddly, twiddly, twiddly bits.
He's always got it. You know, what we're doing from the Paris days, that was the thing we were going for, and Simon completely got it.
You know, really just...
And the glam thing he completely gets.
And his character on stage, always in character.
But when you've got someone as versatile as that, you can pick up an acoustic and you can write a song.
And I was quite honoured when he said, oh, we need another guitarist, can you play guitar on Maggie May? Yeah, he does only let me play one song on guitar.
He ticks all the boxes for me, certainly as a guitarist.
Annalisa Cheng, the Chinese violinist, played with her.
And he's also... can be very funny.
Yeah, very much the comedian.
He's another bastard that will try and make me laugh when we're mid-show. He'll turn around, do something to me with his back to the audience, they can't see what he's doing, and just try and put me off.
The fact that you don't quite know what's going to go on in that stage, because anything can happen, and does.
Between the two of them, it seems to be this sport to try and see if we can crack Chris up, make him lose it. And a lot of the time they do, and a pair of them, fucking nightmare.
Snakebite, it was a White Snake tribute.
Chris is an amazing drummer. I think one thing I would say about Chris is that from the very first day we set on eyes on him in Beats Working, and I mentioned that earlier, that I always just looked at him play and the way he was and realised that actually there was going to be a fantastic gel between him as a musician and me and the other guys.
My first thoughts was, I've never seen this before. I've never seen someone play with such fluidity and made it look effortless.
Great drummer, and always very easy drummer to play with.
You know that if he's behind the kit, he is going to... He's just going to drive it, and he's going to be on the ball.
Blinding. I just remember being total awe.
Because some drummers you work with, it's like, and you're having to listen to them, and you're having to work, and it becomes hard work. But in fact, Chris was just so easy to play with.
He is a great drummer. He's got the nous to be able to just pick up something really quickly.
Brian Connolly.
He just knows what he's playing.
Chris has a particular style of drumming, which just deviates a little bit from other people that you would normally expect to hear.
I'm about to record his second album.
When he's not put off, he's top notch. When Jason gets involved, sometimes, you know, and he starts laughing, and you can tell. And
we used to take the piss out of each other quite a lot and make each other laugh.
I have the honour of being able to turn around quite a lot and get eye contact, and he's just pissing himself laughing sometimes. But he keeps that beat all the time. He is just there. He's just there.
He hits those drums really hard when he needs to, but he doesn't when he doesn't need to. And and great friend. We've known each other for 20, 30 odd years now.
I'm hitting the bass, and the bass is in the air, and I'm actually hitting it like this.
Then I've got to bring Vanessa into this, which to me has been really for the Glamsters, the icing on the cake.
Great performer, great entertainer. She gets it.
Vanessa is brilliant. She is, I think, really where the Glamsters changed for the best.
This is great.
How she's become so much a part of the front of the band. You know, not a backing singer, not anyone that is in the background. She's at the forefront of this.
I think in her previous bands, it probably wasn't, well, it wouldn't have been anything like the Glamsters. But she's quite theatrical, and she just totally gets it what we're doing, and she'll rile a crowd up as much as Jason.
I used this with when I was out with the Mott the Hoople band that we had with Ariel Bender.
I can't say enough about her, really.
She's very talented. She plays a mean saxophone.
She can sing. She can play saxophone. She can play guitar.
And it's great that she plays guitar, because there's bits that we can get her to do.
Years ago, I mean, I always had her in the frame for the job, but I never thought she'd be interested. I just never thought that she'd want to come from being like the sole front person in a rockabilly outfit to get on with a load of crazy guys in lycra and spandex and big hair, really.
I mean, she's a great vocalist and you know, she's a good all-round musician, very attentive and you know, likes to have a lot of fun and enjoy herself, you know, and that for doing that type of music is just absolutely perfect.
She's one of the boys, basically, you know. She can shock any of us, you know, things she might come out with.
We had to share the flight back with Europe at the time. It was a little bit embarrassing, but...
And she is a consummate professional, and actually, at one point, I think she was the driving force behind the Glamsters. When we were all kind of flagging a little bit, she was the one that gave us a kick up the backside and said, come on, we need to get out and do this. And
she was mum for quite a while, wasn't she?
I know that she just shakes her head sometimes, looks as I've had enough of you lot. Will you sort yourselves out? Man up. All that.
In fact, there's footage on YouTube that you can go and see, and you can see that chip actually on it.
And I think for that we thank her for getting us to where we got to, really.
In a mansion.
I don't know about that. I mean, there's everything there, from folk to country to prog rock to a bit of jazz and all sorts of things, you know. It's, yeah.
And then we started to do festivals. Now, they were good fun.
Yeah, the festival thing was good.
Festivals are great. Farmer Phil's particularly... Farmer Phil's down in Shropshire.
It's all about the group, like the group of people, the extended family, and people travelling up to festivals with us. And it was amazing, really, how many people made the effort to go to Shropshire.
And we were one of the very first bands to headline that festival.
Last band on a Saturday night to close the festival.
Because we started out doing the Friday night, the closing band on the Friday night, and then we progressed to the... to the Saturday night.
Close the festival.
And close the festival, didn't we?
And we cut our teeth doing festivals because we found ourselves getting on the bill very late in the evening after the headline act's gone. And we're not like the mop-up band. We are the band that takes that on to that next level after the headline.
We weren't really the headline act. The headline act was on before us. They finished at midnight. We went on at midnight till 2 a.m. as the party band to close the festival. And it really worked.
First one we did, I nearly didn't make it to because the van broke down. My Jeep broke down on the way, and I remember, you know, crying and begging Pete to take me in his works van, and got there, I think, about 10 minutes before we went on stage.
What a great gig. I mean, the atmosphere was phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. And you know, I knew people enjoyed us, but I didn't realise how much they enjoyed us.
And we got quite good at festivals. We would take everyone with us. You know, we had a crew by that stage who would help us out on the bigger shows.
Oh, that looks nice in there. Lovely.
That's it, really. Woke up at 7 o'clock this morning, went into track one, some of the shit on top of the fucking seat. Which was nice.
We build what we'd call the glam village.
A series of tents that would all be interchangeable, and it was like a little village.
We called it the glam village, and you know, we'd have all the big awnings, we'd have, you know, almost marquees there.
Sad lad.
We'd all pull our vans up and our cars up around it.
We had our own personal chef cooking for about 25 people. And the amount of people that were in the area of the artists, and they're in their little two-man tent, and we've got like three marquees, like full of just fun stuff, and we all just look like hanging out. And then that extended family then brings on more people, so you end up having this own little festival in the artists' field, you know, based on fun. You're only here for a visit, and I think that certainly shows in what we do and have done.
What are you doing, Chris?
Having a shave, I was starting to look like a New Age traveller, and suddenly got the urge to dig a series of tunnels and climb a tree. But no. don't have a shave. I feel dirty.
I remember one where we had a full-on djembe session going on in our little glam village. We're all there with our guitars. God knows how anyone slept when we were there.
And we'd hang out. And because we were on so late at night, we had all day to chill out, hang out, watch bands. And then we'd go on at midnight. And that was quite hard going because, you know, you couldn't start drinking at any point. You've got to play it. You've got to play at midnight.
And you want to party, and you're seeing everyone who's coming up to see you partying, getting off their face. You know, you want to join in, and it's a really tough thing.
We'd be drinking tea and eating pot noodles and doing grown-up things rather than being this crazy rock band.
I think when we did those gigs, it just brought us all together more so as a band, because we spent time, you know, our time enjoying stuff away from just playing.
And we got quite good at it. We got quite good at festivals. We'd take everyone with us, you know, wives, girlfriends, friends, crew, and they were good. They were good fun times out.
And so Farmer Fields was great because we'd be going on at 1 o'clock in the morning, and you'd think that by then most punters want to go back to their tents. Nah, they don't. They are up for it. We could have played till 5 o'clock in the morning on all of those occasions.
Because by the time we went on, everyone was absolutely wasted. So the audience are completely mental. We would get up and do our thing. And we played that particular festival several times. Let me get a call one year. So can you play, would you like to play the Bestival? Bestival is a big festival on the Isle of Wight. Main, you know, circuit.
Obviously, we said yes. Well, you wouldn't not say yes.
You know, would you guys be interested in playing Bestival? And it's like, yeah.
Now, Bestival, as it is now, massive, massive big deal.
So we get there, and Bestival is in a valley. We had to go up to the top to our artist accreditation to get all our, you know, artist passes. So we got up there, and then you drive down this dirt road and down into the festival. So we came over the brow of this hill, and then it hit us as you see this enormous festival with tens of thousands of people milling around all these different stages. And it kind of all of a sudden hit us.
It was full of sort of teenagers when we went in there. And I thought, oh my God, they're not gonna get this.
Based between the ages of 16 and 25, and of course we're all going, they're just not gonna get it. They're not gonna know what the hell's going on.
We're the oldest people here. These are all kids. There's thousands of kids at this festival.
And then I'm looking out at the audience thinking, this is not gonna go well at all. I think we all felt the same thing. And there was that kind of trepidation about putting your glam gear on and putting up your spandex and, you know, powdering yourself ready and getting your zip up on your glam top, and then the last final bit of putting your wig on and sort of like looking around the corner and thinking these guys are just gonna crucify us.
And we started to get worried. They're not going to know any of these songs. They're not going to understand all these middle-aged men squeezed into spandex with wigs and platform boots on. And we started to really worry. We thought, we're going to die here.
You're playing with a load of different bands, and there wasn't actually an act as such playing on the same bill as us. So we think, how are we going to turn this around?
Jason, as he always does, said, fuck it. We'll go out there. We'll let them have it. We'll do what we do. And then we'll see.
We just said, we just got to go out there, be ourselves and have fun. Because everything was a bit timid. And it was like, wait till they get a load of us.
There's the usual look of confusion and shock. What the fuck is this?
You could see the shock in their face when we came on. It was just, but you can't just play timidly. You've got to give it large, lots of thrusting.
The first song we went out there, they were like that, gawping at us. And then within second song, they were there. They were with us. It was just crazy.
It was quite bizarre because all of a sudden, you know, the place just came alive.
And by the end of the set, you had people trying to get their head in the marquee because you could not move.
We played a fantastic gig.
They were singing louder than what we were. In fact, at one point, I couldn't actually hear Jason singing. All I could hear was the crowd singing.
Just seeing that whole crowd bouncing up and down from nothing was, to me, a real sense of achievement.
Well, look, we do our thing. Jason does his thing.
I mean, we didn't do anything different from what we normally do.
It was just a brilliant, brilliant night.
Won them over. They went mental. To such an extent, we came off stage, did our usual thing, go straight out the back, try and cool down. I mean, we only played for probably about half an hour, 40 minutes, something like that. But it was still, there was lots of lighting on us, it was hot, you know. Went out the back, try and cool down. And these kids were coming up to us and asking for autographs and saying how brilliant it was.
We got mobbed that night, didn't we?
A bit of a bizarre thing, signing things that Rufus felt. Got quite handy at that in the end.
Kids asking for autographs.
Maybe they thought we were slaved.
Probably. Cheng, the Chinese violinist, played with her.
Yeah, that journey, I mean, that is a lifetime.
For all these years, 30 years now, we've all remained friends.
I have a lot of very, very fond memories about the Glamsters.
It became a massive part of my life.
If I was to kind of cast my eye over the last 30-odd years that we've all played together, I would say there's been some ups and downs, for sure, there always is.
You put any band together, they're going to fall out, there's going to be arguments.
I enjoyed the Glamsters. Out of all the glam rock bands that I've worked with Brian Connolly, Hellraiser, Snakebite, Page and Lemon, Hassan Ranzi, Flair's Sweet FA. Oh, there's all sorts. UFO, Cult, Dumpy's Rusty Nuts, Europe, Rod Stewart, Phil Collins, Roachford, Wet Wet Wet, Chesney Hawks, Jeff King. He's got radio play in America at the moment.
There's no single event that has lasted that long. Sorry, I was thinking something really rude then.
I really appreciate actually being in part of something as good as the Glamsters. Home again, cross the sea, I am sailing stormy
waters to be near you. 30 years later, here we are.
No, there is no other greater thing in your life that you're ever going to have, a greater relationship that you're going to have between a group of friends. You can't start again.
Great, great crowd of guys and people. And we always had a laugh.
We've had lots of great moments of fun, and we've had certainly some happy moments of feeling really proud that we've achieved things.
We've been through the whole thing. Through our 20s, all through our 30s, through our 40s, and now, you know, some of us are 50 now.
You can't suddenly create all that youth and fun.
We're all friends. We were all friends before we started, and I think that's really important.
But musically, we could do anything together, really.
We had a great time doing it. I'd like to think we achieved something. We achieved something with Paris. We certainly achieved something with the Glamsters. At whatever level you might want to put it.
You're just not going to replace it.
For me, I think I don't ever look back and regret at not doing anything with these guys. I think, you know, if I'd have wanted to do something else, I would have done. I'm really pleased that I met everybody. I'm really pleased we're all friends. I'm really pleased that we shared this journey.
We've been through so much together that you can't, you know, ever compare that to anything you've ever done in your life.
And you can look back on it with pride, and you could look back on, you know, 30-year-long friendships.
It's like there isn't anything that fills that void. There's nothing that makes you feel that warm inside than hanging out with your mates, playing glam rock, dressing up, pissing yourself laughing, and it's so natural. So we want it to be
near you, to be free. If I got a call to go and do another gig tomorrow, I would drop some things to go and do it, because it was always fun.
It saddens me to think that, you know, those days are over.
We don't play as much as we did, say, 5 years ago. But every once in a while we get a call, and everyone's diaries line up, everyone's available. And you go in the loft, you dig out the spandex and the wig, you dust it down and you put it on, and you just go and do it one more time. And it still makes me laugh. It's still good. It's still funny. It's still, the energy is still there. And most importantly, whoever comes to see it still has a great night.
I'm ever so proud in every moment of it, because the thing is, it's about fun, and we've had such a great deal of fun up to now.
I'd like to think that, you know, this relationship musically and on a friend's basis will last forever. I'm sure it will.
I'd like to think so. Deep down here, I don't think Puss has ever left the building. So if she can come out to play once more, bring it on.
I couldn't dream of the day of hanging up the drumsticks for good and saying, that's that, you know, put that one to bed, go and do something else. I think we've done it for too long now. Can't can't stop. We're never going to do it to the extent that we once did, but never say never.
That's that. Before I blow up.
No, but it's been a pleasure, and I just hope it's been a nice journey down memory lane.
A nice afternoon.
And a nice afternoon with plenty of tea.
Yes.
Which is great.